we want to open up for questions from the audience? Yes, sir. Are we going to do mics? Just go for it. Yep.
Araceli, for one, made reference to your earlier breakfast with the monitor. It seems obvious that by now, the monitor has been apprised of some of the concerns you just expressed.
Yeah.
On secondary liens and the effects of short sales. With short sales, the impact is compounded by the fact that the homes are often sold to investors rather than being available to first-time homebuyers, for example, or people from the community. So my question is, why did you not echo or reaffirm those questions when he was here?
I think largely because we had just had that conversation with him at breakfast. Okay. And I think it's hard for me anyway, and maybe you guys have it better, to get a sense of what he's really, what latitude he has to push on that stuff. And I don't know, maybe we should know that better.
Questions?
Yes, I.
So this may not be a helpful question, but I'll ask it anyway. So when the period began, when we first started talking about the possibility for an AG settlement, and then, of course, we haven't talked much about IFR today within a justice standpoint. So there was a sense that there will be blood, right? There will be some kind of accountability for the banking sector for this crisis. So my question is for the panel, has there been enough blood? And if not, kind of where do we go now? Because it seems to me that we've been patted on the head a little bit, that you've gotten not everything, you've gotten enough. So have we gotten enough blood?
Well, I mean, surprise, surprise, we haven't gotten any blood. I mean, let's be clear, not one person on Wall Street has gone to jail for this stuff. I mean, there's some other, but that's wrong. I mean, let's remember, they falsified documents. Mm-hmm. You or I do that, we're going to jail. Not one person has even been charged, so I'm going to jail. And then, you know, going back to your first question, I guess one thing that was disappointing or surprising when Joe was talking was this notion of, you know, patting us on the head and, you know, well, you know, it is $25 billion, and the fact that we got the feds and these, you know, Wall Street bankers and, you know, attorneys general together, well, that's to be proud of. Well, no, it's not. You did that because these are the same morons that crashed our economy 5 years ago. There was, you know, you had to do it. So in $25 billion, I mean, we're talking about $1 trillion of lost equity. You know, that's a drop in the bucket. And then when you take the $25 billion and use it to clean your balance sheets, it's really a drop in the bucket. So no, I don't think the question is, have we gotten enough blood? I think the question is, when are we going to start to get some blood? Because right now we haven't.
I mean, I would compare it to the savings and loan crisis where hundreds of people went to jail. Mm-hmm. And I think part of the reason that FACE, my organization, turned to passing state legislation was because we felt that the administration, and I would say Obama was completely culpable in this, simply didn't, you know, they undermined any ability to do that kind of prosecution that needed to happen. And the settlement is partly, I mean, you could see them undermine the settlement as it went through. And so what we got is partly because Treasury didn't back it up. And that didn't happen, you know, I'm a Democrat, but that didn't happen under Reagan. Under Reagan, Treasury pushed for convictions. So,
Araceli?
So just a point of clarification, the $1 trillion that Mark just mentioned, that's only to communities of color. It is a total $2 trillion of lost wealth. But $1 trillion, or slightly over half, to communities of color, specifically African Americans and Latinos. So the disproportionality of the impact of this crisis is significant. Has blood been spilled? Of consumers, of homeowners. They have been the sacrificial lambs. There hasn't been justice done. Center for Responsible Lending has a litigation team, and we have been part in a number of cases, particularly the original case that blew the lid off of the robo-signing case, but not enough. So at the national level, the answer is no.
So, okay, one question, good. Housing Counseling Organization. I wanted to get some of the voices of the housing counselors who've traveled quite far to be here.
But then there's the inequity. Different states, through their attorney generals, did different things with the money. And for my own state, it went, they need jobs. That's what they need. They need jobs.
And you're from Florida?
No, Georgia.
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 And every single dime went to, you can apply for funds for economic development projects, incentives. Mm-hmm. So there's inequity across the country on the highest levels of foreclosure. Georgia is mm-hmm. one of the states, and there's a huge Latino and African American population in Georgia. And there's inequity on how the hardest hit funds are distributed and how they're spent. Our state hired a bunch of underwriters. It's like talking to robots. Well, you can't talk to them, you have to email. And they have no documents in anything but English. There's inequity everywhere. The recovery of the states due to the economy, they're not recovering at the same rate. Mm-hmm. So, for example, the state of Georgia out of 50 states, we're number 26. So there's inequity across the board, and that's part of my frustration, is there's an inequity to the borrowers of color, but there's inequity across the board everywhere, and that's part of my frustration in the whole process, is how do we address the inequities?
Okay, all right, question with no answer. Question, other questions from housing counselors and housing counseling agencies? Yep.
I'm Steve Torsell. One of the things that we see, since people can't, people get themselves into credit issues, and they no longer can access normal types of financing that we're talking about here with regular banks, and especially for people of color, oftentimes they end up in land contract deals and subsidized sort of financing that's really curious to figure out. And I'm interested in your experience. If you see people coming into your offices with that type of situation, and what are you able to do for them in response to this kind of question? Because sometimes their paperwork is so convoluted or so prejudiced against the potential buyer that they've just signed themselves away. We try to deal with, of course, in the front end with education, but a lot of times by the time we see people, it's way too late. The other incident that always happens when people come to our classes and they're in this situation, we start to tell them about what's available and what they might be able to do. Of course, people are getting loans that they could get better loans, but I'm interested in your experience in that area.
So, I mean, fortunately, we don't see a lot of land contracts and things like that. When we do, regrettably, we just don't have the resources to deal with that. So we'll refer them on. I mean, sometimes we can do something, but I think to the other product, certainly payday lending is a huge one. Title loans are now growing in the state of Ohio. That was something 2 years ago that didn't exist. Those areas we're able to do a little bit more. So we've worked with some credit unions to develop an alternative to payday lending. We've developed a quasi product with a U.S. bank to deal with that. And then certainly one of the more proactive things that we're doing is hooking up with a credit union to expand services specifically to low-income and minority census tracts, recognizing the banks, you know, they've left, they're not coming back. And they're not just leaving the inner city. Their banking is going away. It's all going mobile, and so they're leaving the suburbs too. And unfortunately, the 85-year-old that lives on Easton, on the southeast side of Cleveland, doesn't have a computer. She's not doing mobile banking, so there's an unfilled gap there. But on the mortgage side, I mean, we just don't have the capacity to deal with, you know, those, you know, the land contracts and that kind of financing.
Drew?
So inside the Filipino community in Hawaii, we did have issues with that. And there was one particular bad actor. And, like, again, one of the good things that came out of the settlement was we sort of rebooted our consumer protection agency, and they are on that case. I don't know what the results of it are going to be, but we didn't have the capacity to deal with it either. So we turned it over to them. I'm not sure that that's going to be, I don't know how that'll be dealt with. And I think the sort of dirty secret of this of the sort of part of this industry is that a lot of these smaller fly-by-night people is people in our community doing it to our community. And strong consumer protection, you know, strong enforcement on the AG part might make a difference there.
So I would add that what you're speaking to is some of the outcomes of the crisis is the harm, right, to credit of consumers and their ability to then get subsequent credit later on. And so for the time being and for the very near future, they're sort of like destined to get more expensive credit going forward. What you're speaking to in terms of land contracts is more prevalent in rural areas in places like Texas. As a data collecting organization and on my CDFI side as a financing organization, we are collecting anecdotal data. We don't have hard data on it. In those areas, it particularly impacts Latinos and African Americans, in Texas more so for Latino families and immigrant families that are not very familiar with real estate law and don't necessarily get good representation on those deals. But they end up with really raw deals. And I think that a lot of people have now begun to ask, if 60% of the people that received predatory loans got those loans through no fault of their own because they could have qualified for better credit, what are we going to do as a matter of policy recommendation to actually help them have access to financing in the future? And not just home mortgages, but whether it is a credit card or auto financing, right? Or are we relegating these folks to get high-cost credit cards and high-cost loans across the board, including payday loans and car title loans?
We have time for one, maybe two more questions.
I have a quick question. Hi, I'm Cheryl from Raleigh, North Carolina. I just wanted to ask, there's been a lot of attention on this settlement for $25 billion, and we know there's another settlement for $10 billion out there, so just wanted to know if the Alliance is doing anything, and is there a monitor for that particular money, and any insight you can provide to that?
That's a good question. I mean, we haven't talked about next, so maybe that's a good way to close. Are there any other burning questions before we turn to a close?
Yes, okay. I was just hoping that the speakers could maybe speak upon how banks have followed through in their commitment to actually contact victims of predatory lending. And maybe you could give examples from your respective constituencies to maybe describe if that's happening, if banks are being effective, and maybe about enforcement mechanisms to make sure that they do.
Okay, so we're gonna use those two questions to wrap up this panel. And so if you all could just say a little bit, because we have so many housing counselors, they're the ones who still have to, in the chaos, that is all of the different settlements and things coming down. If you could just give a nugget of a recommendation about whether it is that they're doing the story banking, like what is it for housing counselors? I'd like you guys to also incorporate that into your final message. And then the other question was around accountability for future settlements and the one with the OCC right now. And then sort of what we will do as the Alliance, which I'm actually going to toss to Cy, who's going to close us out. So hopefully we'll be able to do that. So go ahead.
I mean, from our end, and I mentioned this earlier, as far as the contacting the accountability for it, you know, we saw it with the IFR too, which, you know, became, saying my own comment, but they're not. And in fact, it's very clear, and this is true with all of them, the folks doing the settlement handouts or the letters are not at all contacting the counselors who are, for the most part, dealing with loss mitigation. We talk to our single points of contact, and that we've talked to for years in some cases, and they know, we ask them, how's this working? They know nothing. They put us in touch with those that supposedly knew something, and they said, well, we don't know anything, or we'll get back to you. It's really a squandered opportunity. If I were a conspiracy theorist, I might say they're doing that intentionally, but I'm sure it's not. It's just a level of incompetence on their part. As far as, you know, future settlements, I guess I would say the same thing. I mean, you know, you look at the IFR, we were contacted in the middle of December through one of the banks or through a network of one of the banks to reach out to folks. December 15th is when we signed that contract. you all know it expired December 31st, and we had that little holiday thing. That's ludicrous. And so I think, you know, one thing certainly going forward that we should be aware of is, you know, counselors know what they're doing. And if you involve them at the beginning and not at the very end after we have example after example where the industry screws up, we can usually make it better.
True.
So I would say just really quick response to your question about individual banks. I saw Bank of America change somewhat in relationship to pressure on the outreach. So I think their outreach was better post having a series of meetings with them, with the housing counselors, than it was before. So you sort of credit to where credit is due. They got better by degrees. I think for the housing counselors specifically, what has been key to our success in Hawaii, and again, we cut foreclosures by 78%. Maui was the fifth worst county in the country 5 years ago, and now there's still substantial numbers of foreclosures, but nowhere near where they were. And we were effective doing that because housing counselors were linked up with strong advocacy organizations. And it's the housing counselors that had the stories. It's the housing counselors that could produce people for testimony. And the then director of the housing counseling agency was really forceful person for testimony, and I think could counter the arguments that banks made against passing the law that we passed. And I think, so that's, I, if you're not connected, you should connect. And just like all housing counselors are not created equal, neither are all advocacy organizations. So you gotta be kind of selective about who can actually do the job, and then do it. On the future settlement stuff, the thing that I regret most of all of this, and it's like taking a couple steps back, is when you looked at the tobacco settlements, they established those legacy institutions that would then, you know, become the centers of power that would fight with the, you know, cigarette people down the road. And they've now been around for years, and you can't get away from their ads almost everywhere you go. I wish that we had done that with this settlement, and to the extent that we have the chance to do it with the next one, I think we should do it. Because the federal institutions are just too weak to do it by themselves.
Araceli.
So that takes us down to community engagement is key, right? And it has to be part of the strategy. It's very hard work. It can be backbreaking, heartbreaking, lots of sweats and tears. But it has to be done. And I mean, if a home is not worth fighting for, then what is it, right? And so I have to tell you, speaking specifically for the community where I live in Prince William County, we actually had to organize. We had no infrastructure. There were no nonprofit organizations like these organizations in Prince William. Throughout the crisis, one organization tried to come into the picture, and they still did not know what they were doing or how they were doing it. We had to go to the leaders of our community, and those were faith-based leaders. And we created a coalition that is called Voice. Virginians organized, I can't remember what the rest of it stands for, but these are faith leaders. So these are Catholics, Episcopalians, Baptists, Jewish community, Muslims coming together because these faith leaders are actually listening to the woes of the families that come to their temples and their churches of worship. And so having no resources, you know, somebody like me who represents a policy organization got into the business, and Angela's still in the room, and Bruce Dorr-Palin, who would pick up the phone call when I would call him because consumers were reaching to me. They had no place else to go. And I would call Bruce on December 31st. You know, my home is being auctioned January 3rd. Can you help me out? And Bruce would be the one that would pick up that phone call and try to mobilize somebody. And we imported. And Angela from Bank of America, to give her credit, she came out to my neighborhood, to my neck of the woods, to actually see what families were going through. But we've engaged in door knocking activities, very hard work, neighborhood by neighborhood. And so that has to continue. We need to empower people. There is a great sense of shame and embarrassment, and sort of like it's an acknowledgement that somehow perhaps I have failed to manage my finances, somehow I have done wrong, and that has got to stop. It is within the power of financial institutions and lenders to actually evaluate credit worthiness, ability to repay, and approve loans. And so if he had not served them right, because we had this secondary market, horrible incentives that were misaligned in terms of approving loans and very quickly turning them on to somebody else on the secondary market and distancing yourself from performance, you know, if we had not had that, things would be different. So what can we do in the future? We need to remain engaged, and we need to work at all levels, and we need to continue to do these conversations so that we can continue this choir, the echo chamber, so that change can actually happen and relief can go down to our communities and the people that have been most hurt, and learn from this experience of this particular settlement so that the next one can perform better.
Okay, great. So I just wanted to, Sai, come start walking up here. Just say thank you to all of the housing counselors in the room. You all are navigating very tough waters out there, dealing with, families in distress. You are speaking many languages and really are the bridges between the chaos that is federal policy and what is policies for financial institutions. We talked about language access issues a lot with Joe Smith this morning. We didn't talk a lot about it on this panel, but that was also raised, and I just wanted to note that for the record. So thank you to the housing counselors. So let's give a round of applause to the housing counselors and also to Sai is coming back up here to close us out. Thank you.